So, today I'm going to start with Nautilus, I think. So, where am I? Let me just get the right screen in front of me. So, yeah, Nautilus. Let's just have a look at RPM Curial and grab for Nautilus. I'm not sure if that package is even still called Nautilus. Yeah, it is. So we have a trunk load of 'stuff here, and seems that there are also other packages that hook into Nautilus. So let's peruse stuff a little bit, just to have get an impression. By the way, you might hear some weird sounds again because they're working on my roof. Okay, so these are just libraries, so that's no problem. Nautilus, let's grep for Nautilus, or grep, let's Nautilus. Oops. All right, so here we have some stuff. We have Nautilus itself, we have Nautilus Auto Run software, and we have Nautilus Connect Server. And then we have Convert Metadata, and we have the Shell Search Provider. That seems to be about it. And yeah, well, it seems already that a lot of them are DBus services, as we can see evidenced from these entries. So the search provider is a DBus session, and Nautilus seems to be a DBus, also DBus. I thought there was more Nautilus, by the way, but seems not. If it is, then we'll see. So yeah, we have these, at least these, and I'll just copy them over, and then go. Nano, my login user, let's see what we already have for Nautilus. We already have a bunch of stuff. We have Nautilus here, Nautilus Auto Run, we have Nautilus, we have Nautilus Sento, which was actually not, that was a separate package. That's just Auto Run software we have. Connect Server, we should have Connect Server already. I'm pretty sure about that. Nautilus Shell Search Provider is also already there. So let's just remove that as well. Convert Metadata, do we have Nautilus Convert Metadata? We have some Convert Metadata. Let's just no, that's different. So that seems to be the only one as connect. This should we already have. Yep, that's already there. So yeah, that supposedly, and do we have Nautilus itself? Yeah, we did. So supposedly we only have this as a to-do. so. Just label that. And then just I'll just make that a single string. Now that I convert. All right, and this save and exit here. We're gonna go to type enforcement file and at least start by adding a new section. Here we have send to, and we can basically use this. And just replace it. So that'll take at least take care of the labeling. First things first, but just slow. Let's see if it's something in here is in my history. What was the path again? We need to restore it. This is the path. Restore. Oh, so seemingly that is just everything. Okay. But that's just seemingly. I'm pretty sure that this will have a lot of dependencies that we also need to confine. So let's just have a look back and make sure that at least Nautilus itself transitions. This is the search provider. This is the connection connect server. And this is Naut. So Naut just actually started at least started from GNOME shell, just like file roller is. So we can at least add these rules here. So that it can be started from the GNOME shell. And that should get us started at least. So it's basically not. Of not. In English it's not naut. Like naughty and not naughty. So yeah. also, we forgot about this one here. So yeah, we need to take it slow. So just start with one transition and then see what else gets spawned. So this should be it. Let's build it again. Let's install it again. Let's start with cleaning up our directories and processes and stuff. Because I think I forgot that last time when I logged off. So, kill alls, where are you? Oh, and I'm going too far, probably. Not. Get that a little bit higher up in my buffer. There's some other stuff in here that I'll just remove as well. Still left there. Like for example this one here, events. And some Yelp related stuff that it failed to unlink. Pulse audio, of course. And another Yelp related file. And I'm not sure what these probably are XDM logs. I guess. I'm not sure, but I haven't seen them before, but I know that I saw an X5 log and now it's an X4 log, so I'm probably it's probably related to the amount of times it's restarted or the amount of times you logged off or something. I'm not sure what it means, but that was just something that I noticed, that now it's X4 log, but I have also seen an X5 log, so it seems like it's incrementing. Alright, let's have a look at that home disk, see if there's nothing dangling. And nothing's, oh yeah, there's some stuff that's dangling, output. I should clean it up. So now we're clean. Alright, so we have our stuff set up. So guess, oh, let's just make it in permissive mode. Alright. So we logged on in permissive mode. Let's have a look. It's early. It's not even 9 o'clock in the morning. And I made it a pretty late evening last night. So we have 8:57. It's clean. So let's just run and start and run Nautilus. that takes a while. Are we in permissive mode? Oh no, we aren't. So that's why it's crapping out. 740, not getting 40. Right. Now let's do that again. So here we have a whole bunch of stuff that we need to just think about. Let's have a look at the stuff that's getting executed. So, for example, GVFS executes something, so we need to take care of, see what it actually executes, and make sure that it domain transitions. And here we have the usual going on, it's trying to get attribute of Nautilus Sentu, but it doesn't, and here, same for Dayadev, but it's, these are just MAPs. So it doesn't actually run them. And then it hooks into Pulse Audio. But other than that, I don't see anything out of the ordinary yet. It's also getting a service on the system bus, or connecting to the system bus one. But other than that, no execution. So basically we need to focus on this one here, GVFS. So let's just grep for execute neutrons. Grep execute neutrons. Let's see what's going on there. It's probably some GVFS GVFS trash. Yeah. So we need to take care of that. So we need to take care of this. That's fine. So it's getting actually run by GVFSD. So this is a GVFS daemon, or a GVFSD daemon. Alright, let's get back to our file context file. So this is one of those dependencies I was talking about. There's going to be a shitload of more of those. I'll just add them below. And oops. Whoops. So call it GVFSD trash. And it's getting a little bit dark in here already, and it's not even the day ending started yet. So yeah, GVFSD trash. GVFSD and then trash. And I'll just copy this over so that I can use it. Save and exit. Type a force file and just go all the way below. One of the many dependencies. But now I can basically already copy this over. But we also already know, we also can do the transition already. Because you know that GVFS runs it. GVFS is like basically the main hub of all these GVFSD utilities. Just like GSession, for example, is the main hub for all the applets. And that's with Gnome. These the various stuff have various hubs. Back in the day, for example, gconf was an important hub as well, I think that it was. Or gateway, I'm not sure what you would call it best. Make sure that I restore context that file, by the way. So let's just also copy this over, then just add that, and then don't forget to actually restore the context. But instead of Dbus, this is not run by Dbus, so you can change that as well. First things first, though. Alright, so it's actually getting run by GVFSD. So let's change Dbus to GVFSD, GVFSD. And then just copy this over and apply that elsewhere. Dbus is no longer, doesn't apply here. It's actually getting run by GVFSD. It's unfortunate that I only see a single transition. There might actually, nah, there's no, not more either, because else I would have seen it, probably. So this is it. Save and exit. Build, and then make sure you get that file context sorted out. Yeah, we're gonna need that soon. That clear stuff and remove stuff. We're going to be doing that a lot, probably. Yeah, this is quite, should be quite a project, this. So yeah, take care of that. I guess let's just log off and start over. And clear stuff. Kill the processes, run the scripts, and then ls-alt-z temp, and remove my pools temp file. All right, let's see where we stand. At 9:07. Yeah, we're clear. We're in the clear. So let's log in. Well, by now you should probably know the drill. It's basically that whole story all over again. First, just test it in permissive. Get all these transitions sorted out. And then at some point, so it's running another bin file here, but we actually transition to trash here, but it's running another bin file here, so we need to get that sorted out as well. So we can basically go back and get that other crap for no trans. And let's have a look. Burn. So it's the same stuff. You can just basically just copy this over from trash. So let's go to the file context file. Basically at some point you might say, oh yeah, why do we have to run all these DVFS programs in separate domains? And you got a point there. There's probably really no need to create separate domains for each of them, but it gives you more flexibility though, because it actually allows you to specify, and whether that makes sense or not is if whether the user can actually run use trash or actually use burn. But if you basically and you can do that in a elegant way if you basically do this, because you can then just disallow it to run the file, and that will then just basically error out in a elegant way, rather than the way that Nautilus recently crept out when we tried it earlier this morning, the first time, when I basically mistyped the set enforce and used again a 4.0. Basically, it was just trying to run it, but it didn't have the permissions, and so it took a long time for it to actually quit, instead of just getting a nice message, okay, permission is denied, and move on. So that's one of the benefits, but yeah, it comes at a cost, because yeah, well, you'll be creating new types and new rules here, and that's basically expensive. But at some point, I might just decide to just basically merge all these DVFS domains into a single domain and just simplify the policy. It's just a matter of what are your goals, what are you trying to achieve here. And in my case, this is just a study, so to speak. I'm just looking at all the possibilities. I don't have a specific goal right now. I just want to have all the possible goals, so to speak. But I could imagine that a goal could be that you just want to make sure that users have a great base to potentially confine applications on. So just basically have GNOME confined, have the base, DVFS, have the base confined. But not so much have much granularity in that base. Just make sure that the base system does not have to communicate with the user domain. That's one benchmark, so to speak. An important benchmark, because that's one of the important things when you confine the desktop. You just want to make sure that it doesn't communicate with the user domain. Because the user domain is basically a one big domain where everything runs in that doesn't run confined. So if it runs in the user domain, then it's not confined. So basically the unconfined domain, so to speak, but not literally, but okay. So the same drill again. This is probably going to have to be doing this a couple times. Oh, I've got, or I did some stuff wrong while I was talking. yet. The first one, actually. GVFSD. But hopefully that's the only one. Yeah. So it's all about your goals. But the way I do it now basically leaves that open. I can always make it more I can always make it simpler if I'd like later on. This just gives me that flexibility ahead of actually making that decision. Oh, I'm sorry. I need to just restore. Gone. Burn. But yeah, now I just basically have to do this stuff all over again, log out and see what else it executes, if it executes anything else. Until I have it all cleaned out. And XEM is crapping out currently. Happens every once in a while. That, and I think it actually had to do with that X4, X5 file, where it basically has a limit of 5 times logging in, logging out. And that's a limitation, a serious limitation. Let's see if it's now at X1 again. Yeah, X0, so it's actually, it has six times login. When it comes to X5, it basically crashes. So this might be something to report. I'm not sure if this is basically by design or actually a bug. But it seems that you can basically just log out six times and then it just crashes. Yeah, it just hangs. That's just something to be aware of. Those are the things that you notice when you actually start confining stuff. You do things that other people usually don't do. Like logging out a lot. Alright, let's see where we stand with AVC denials. We can't really use the current AVC denials, so we can ignore those. We just need to make sure that we have the transition sorted. It's all about transitions currently. We have a little bit wet weather. Yesterday it started raining and today it's still cloudy. So it's not good weather if you're suffering from bronchitis or any of that stuff. But it's, at least it's not that warm either. So yeah, let's just run Nautilus. This is weird. Oh, now it's fixed. So let's see what that gave us. Do we have any execute no chances? This is grab execute no chance. Grab execute no chance. No. So that means that we can get started. But yeah, we can get started. Let's just first take care of GVFS deburn. I'll just grab GVFS deburn and then grab create. That way I'll probably see what it's creating. So it's creating a dir in use of pt33. So is that somewhere in run user as all the run user, run user deconf maybe, no, it should be that. 10.12. Yeah, it's just creating it straight up in run user. So yeah, that explains something. Let's go to type enforcement file. DVFS deburring and add these few rules that we already have and make sense of out of them. So we need a temp file type. It's connected to the session bus, by the way, so it's chatting. It's chatting. And just take care of this type. So we have a type here which is called burn tempty. I'll just call it burn. Type attribute burn tempty. Yeah. File type. Yeah, that's what it is. Oh, and it's also two other classifications. Do you know what they are? Right, you're right. It's a temp file. It is, because you can see it's created in a user temp file. So we just treat it, whether it's a real temp file or not, we just treat it as temp, because we want to basically stick in the design of the upstream. And then we have user temp type. Yeah, it's a user temp file, so to speak. So we classify that as a user temp type. Okay, now we can basically split this up in twos. So it creates that dir, that DVFS burn. And basically what it does is this. And actually let it search as well and search here as well, but allow this to create to add a name and to write, because makes sense, because you don't create a dir just to create a dir, obviously. So type transition, it wants to create something in there sooner or later, it's obvious. And of course you can just say but don't assume anything. That's right, you shouldn't assume anything, but if it's that obvious, then might as well. Or rather not, preferably not, but and then it's DVFS deburn, I think, or is it DVFS burn? I don't know, I'll need to verify that. So this take care of, and it's not a user home type, it's a user temp type. DVFS, that's always the same bullshit. You just don't know whether it uses DVFSD or DVFS. Alright, so but that take care of it. And we don't have much more rules with regard to this yet, so we just basically have to start with what we have. And then we have trash. No, so let's see what trash is all about. Trash doesn't actually create anything yet. Let's just copy this over. Paste that in trash. This is the trash section, and then just see what we have. Not much revealing currently, except that of course it needs to search homebrew T to search user home T, and deconf T and data home T, so we can basically add some stuff here already. So for example this here, I'll just add that on top, and replace this. but it actually also wants to reach the dirt. So don't mind all the noises. People are very productive here in Holland. They're cutting the grass, they're fixing the roof. Very productive indeed. Not sure if open applies to girls. So we can remove this one here. And remove this one. Now we need to take care of it traversing these homes. Yeah, this stuff here. It's now time to convert. Oh yeah, we added that in probably, yeah, we did. So I'll add that over here. And that'll take care of the DVFS stress. For now. So we have plenty dependencies. Then it basically also connects to the session bus. And since it also needs to traverse user tempi, but that's too far fetched, so I'm going to just ignore that for now. But it probably wants to get to that period DVFS there in user run, run user, sorry. But that will show up eventually. There's so much to do anyway, so. With what we have first. Alright, so save and exit. Yeah. Let's go ahead and go back. So now we're at Nautilus itself. And it doesn't execute anything, so this should be all valid. Or valid. This should all be legit, so to speak. Legitimate. And let's go to type enforcement file. Then we have various nauts. Knots, sorry, I keep saying knots. So I'll just paste this in. And then we're going to have to just go through this again. You know the deal. We did this plenty times before. So one of these obvious things, fonts. So let's just take care of fonts. Now, like File Roller also does fonts. So we're just going to do that as well. Go all the way on top and just say, okay, fonts, you have access to fonts. Not a big deal. They need to basically print text to the graphical screen. So they need fonts. Else you get those blocks symbols. And that's not nice. Users cannot read that. Let's get some other obvious stuff. That deconf temp stuff. It's so obvious. Everybody uses it. Everybody uses it. So let's just hear. Right? Well. They all do that. Add that in. They all do that. So then we can remove these, this, and to use the empty stuff. Now we have that X server stuff is also obvious. Every graphical user interface does the X server dance and the XDM dance. So where is it? Here it is. The X server dance. Let's paste that in. These are just those patterns that you can at some point you'll see them. Think, when I do this, this happens, and it happens every time. Then that must be a pattern. That's basically what you see here. They're all stream connecting to X server. They're all reading XDM pit file, or yeah, some file, at least classified pit file. And then it's they're all reading that read write that's generic tempfs file. This, by the way, sucks, but it's, well, it's not that big of a problem, but it sucks. Would be nice if it wouldn't be a generic tempfs type. So we can remove this stuff here. So it's stream connecting all over the place. This is also something that gconf, so basically it's traversing the whole place. So we could already, for example, add this. We know it's traversing. Also homebrew key and stuff like that. It's actually probably it's actually creating files in data home. So we can actually just make that a bit, just work on that a bit. Because obviously it's it's creating content everywhere, and we need to take care of that as well. Notes. Just take it easy, no rush. There's no reason to rush. Actually reasons to not rush. See, rushing only means mistakes. So what actually happens here? So this actually, there's all kinds of weird stuff. And that write, what you see here, seems to be writing or checking for a write. The same happens. Yeah, same here, it's writing all over the place, and I have had that before. We can just don't audit that and allow audit access on write. Yeah, I saw, and this was the same with GNOME 2 with the Nautilus, the old Nautilus. It was just writing all over the place. Well, not actually writing, but. So we can remove this here, the home root. And with regard to the other stuff, let's just wait and see. Gconf is actually listing it. And let's just take care of this already, or at least take care of just cherry pick it out. So this day it dub, and it's also now the center. This basically checking for exec for some reason, and I have a feeling that it's going to be checking for exec other stuff as well. I'll just cherry pick those out. Now to the center. All right. So what is happening here? Let's just take care of the file transitions first. By the way, now we really, that I already said it, but we really need to ignore the writes that you see here. It isn't actually writing. It's not writing to my bash config. This is just some stupid thing it does. It checks for write. There's some check it does in the code. And it appears that it's riding, but it's not riding. And if it is, then it shouldn't be, but it isn't. So let's just grep for create here. Grep create. And less that. And then let's have a look at what it's creating. So it's creating, we have the DVFS burn. It's creating Nautilus dir in config home. It's creating a Nautilus dir in data home. And it's creating an Excel's dir, a file in config home. Let's just have a look, closer look at that. LS LZ home, my login user. Now, first let's do config. And then you have that Nautilus there here, which is currently created with a generic type. And we're going to need to take care of that. So, and it does it actually create a, it seems to be creating a Excel's file in here. Let's confirm. Yeah, so it's actually creating an Excel's file in there. And now let's just also local, was it data? Was it data or cache? Yeah, I think it's data. Local share. And then you'll probably also find a Nautilus dir in here. Yeah, so we need to take care of that stuff. How do we go about that? Well, we first start with creating those file context specifications. So we have a local share, and I'll just copy this one here. Local share Nautilus. And we call that Nautilus data home too. And we have a config. Now let's just take this one here and call it Nautilus. Nautilus config. So that this stuff is classified. Save and exit. Type a forcing file. Search for Nautilus. Oh, and not like that. Next, this one here. Let's just do this on top though. So we'll have to create a couple types. Type Nautilus config home t. Type attributes. No, and I'll just copy it. Oh, might as well type it though. And it's a file type. And it's a user home type. I'll just do it the easy way. Take care of this for now, but let's just have a look. Get a general idea here. So for example here, this stuff, let's copy this over. And so config of Nautilus config. So how that does that happen? So first of all, you need to be able to actually do some stuff to the config there, to the period config there. So let's copy this over. You need to search. Oh, and it probably wants to write, but we need to actually take care of that. But we don't. We don't need to take care in this case now, because it actually needs to write directory entries. So we have write search, read for listing, that there, that's fine. But it does need to create generic there's. But it needs to add names. And this all applies to our Nautilus. Nautilus config. Consider, because yeah, it actually needs to write an entry, a directory entry, because it's creating that Excel file in there. It needs to search it, because it should be able to get to that Excel file, so it needs to traverse. With regard to listing it, I'm not sure, but I think Nautilus just lists and writes, lists and writes all over the place, like a dog in heat. Some check, probably inside some of the libraries it's using. It needs to be able to create and create attribute and add name. So this seems to be okay here. And now with regard to the file, Nautilus config home key. And then just add a type transition. Type transition. For Nautilus. So at least now we're getting that out of the way. We're transitioning on the config there. We're transitioning to Nautilus config home T. And we can use a named file transition here, Nautilus. So that's cool. If you can use a named file transition, always use it. Make these transitions rules so as narrow as possible, so that you can leave yourself room open. What you see in Fedora policy, for example, is sometimes without with normal file type transitions, is that they just transition on any object. So if that, for example, some domain creates a dir and it needs to create the content inside that dir with a type, then they basically file transition on any possible object. So for example, dirs, files, link files, FIFO files, the whole shebang. But then you're basically shutting your own doors, because it only needs to file type transition on the dir, and inside that dir it just creates these other objects with the type inherited from the parent, which is the dir with the right type. So you only need to type transition on the dir. But if you add rules where it says, okay, type transition dirs files, all of that stuff, then basically if you later need to basically transition on another class of an object, for example, if you actually need that domain to create a file with a file type transition in that there, then you basically really can't, because you already have a file transition for a file, which is really not needed. But the question is, do you still know at that point that it's really not needed? Because do you remember why you added that rule where you said, okay, type transition on the file to that type? Do you, at that point where you really need it, do you still remember why you did that? And if you just don't do it, then you don't have to remember why you did something, because you didn't do it. See? And it sounds like nitpicking, maybe. But actually, once you get into confining the user space, and really, in this case, it with these named file transitions, it gets less important. But in the old days, when you didn't have the named file transitions, well, and you really had to depend on your flexibility with regard to file type transitions, then it was really important that you just be very conservative with how you use it. But nowadays you have these named file transitions, and makes it a lot easier. So here we have the stuff. So basically what we can do is just inspire our stuff based on the config. So we have write, search, read, but we don't need create. We actually have an open here. We don't need to create, but we do need to open, I guess. Because to be able to read it, you'll probably want to open it. And then there is this one. So we'll just leave that in. Then we have this type transition, which you can basically copy over and change it a little bit. Pretty much the same. Oh yeah, and data on T, we have this here. So we can remove this, or actually we can just add this. Top of there, and then oh yeah, that, and that's not, oh yeah, that's right, and then change this, so we have that in data home t, nautilus data home t. So this should take care of a lot of this stuff, and then it's reading generic cache. Do I have anything generic? Imagine that. And it's reading a lot of stuff which we can also take care of. So it has that GTK stuff. Now, you better believe that it needs to actually do the whole GTK dance. So we can basically have a look at something else that does the GTK dance here. And we can copy that in. Then just change that. And we don't need this here. Yeah, you know, Nautilus uses bookmarks. So you know, basically. So that's a GTK thing. Gconf, so gconf, let's take care here of gconf, of that write. Actually, let's just do that in a, with a comment. So basically what we're going to say here is reads and writes, or check reads and writes checks. Read, write, and then basically add these rules in here, and I'll just comment them out for now. So first, don't audit, and then the type, and then basically say for all user home type, and then in this case it's just about a dir, but. Let's just keep it right for now, but it's also reading everything. And then just allow. Alright, copy this over. Right, or allow. Allow. Audit access. Checks read write, and in this case we just did write, but it also probably checks read. So comments, and ignore that then basically for now. That basically explains some stuff. So we can remove this one. We have eyes out, which is also commonly done. We have the pulse audio dance, we have ebers. Does Farrell do ebers? Or ibers, whatever you would like to call it. Thought so. Read recently used probably also. But we'll see that later. But I don't see, oh yeah, here it is. It was, so just copy this over. A lot of work or this. Better believe it. Pretty sophisticated app. So that's Ibis. And then we have Ice Out. Oh, and here we have DTK again. I thought I'd remove that. Ice Out. Do we have Ice Out? Ice Out. Nah, but some of these. Main apps do. I have here that this stuff here we can allow this as well. This is basically reading that that deconf stuff. So let's allow that as well. And do that where it's actually, well, just do it here. And config home t certificate attribute, well, we already have that. So we don't need that. But we do need this. So that's a deconf home stuff here. It's a gconf, it wants to read that as well. So we can basically basically expand that. So let's just do that. Apprentice. It's just reading it. Okay. This is just testing. It's testing this whole piece of stuff. But we can't, we for now we should just ignore it. But it's actually just doing, I can basically read, write, get attribute. And then allow to create attribute that's, and it's not just for hors, by the way, it's for everything. This guy needs to do stuff like a dog in heat. I'm not sure why. But I'm going to remove it for now. And this one is actually reading bash, but it's not. It's actually doing something to bash, probably reading it. But I'm removing these for now. Oh yeah, ice outs. So the write is actually not needed here. But we're going to have to look for an ice out first. See how, what else, ice out. This is not it. She's just a read write get attribute. Oh, a read open and get attribute, sorry. So never mind the noise. They're roofing. They are roofing. So you can actually see here that it does extra stuff, that write is not needed at all. But it's just checking all these files for write, so that's why it's showing up. So this is really something that I know from experience. If you do this for the first time, then you think, oh, it's just writing that file, but it isn't. It isn't. Oh, we have these stream connects here, so we'll just leave those in. And then we have here, it pulls audio, and this basically we'll just for now leave these out. And the same goes for this, because it's basically just it wants to get all over the place. Same for this stuff here. That's just basically it listing your home directory. It's showing, displaying your home directory. And we'll take care of that later in a one rule that applies to all user home content. So. Dbus. So it's actually doing some connecting to the system bus. So we do have others. For example, network manager applet, I think. NM applet connects to the system bus. Isn't it? I thought it was. Should be using the system bus to talk to network manager at some point. I guess not currently. Do we have something else that actually connects to the system bus? I know we have something. Just don't know, remember what it is. So let's just search for it. System dbusd. D session. Do we have something a little bit more neatly? This is also not very tidy. Get attribute in here. Don't we have anything more tidy? No, we don't. It's just one hell of a mess. But we'll clean it up right now so that in the future if we'll use it, it'll be more clean. So yeah, let's just go back. Nout. And just do this the clean way. In blocks, you know, we work in blocks, in patterns. So just place this in here and then just add a tab. So basically what you this search and get attributes, so we can basically expand this one. So it's basically one single event, so to speak, var lib t, and actually also a var t, but that's allowed by default, so we don't have to add that. But and then this stuff here, and then just change that now. So this is the block that pertains to connecting to the session system bus. So so now we can remove this system bus stuff. And we already had the session bus above. So this should take care of that. So now we have it. We have most of the common stuff. So let's just think about it. It wants to actually, so if you run it, you want it to basically, you want to basically allow the user to use it to just manage his home directory. But only, and this kind of sucks. Let's see. Oh, yeah, we can't see. Well, let's see just in here. So if you do this, then you can create a folder. You can create a folder. Can we create a file? New folder. No, so we just we can just create folders in here. Let's try to do this in a neat way. You know, because, well, actually, yeah, we need to do this in the same way that we do it in the shell, for a normal shell, but even less than that. So let's just think about this for a while. Let's just see how we do this in the shell. So in the shell, we basically do the following. Initial access to the user home door. So it's already allowed to search. And then here we have this stuff. Let's copy this over, go to Nout. And first just allow what should be allowed. So Nautilus should be allowed to do the following. Nouts. So we already have some stuff to use at home there, just searching to get attributes. So we will remove that. Actually, let's just put this in here below so that we have a single block here. So we have a search and get attribute, we already have that in here. And then it basically needs to add remove name, search, read, write, name, log, IO control. Let's just allow this. And then it needs to be able to create theirs. But not relabel. But you should be able to remove the dir. So this is actually getting pretty. And as for user home files, it needs to be able to read them, but not relabel them. Not sure if it needs to lock them. But let's just allow that. Unlink, I'm not sure if it needs to link. Rename, yeah, it needs to rename. Append, I don't think so. Write. No. Set attributes, yes. Get attributes, yes. Open and create. No, you can't use Nautilus to create files directly, as far as I know. But you can for a DIRS. And then the same applies for link files, I guess. But link files don't open, I guess. So you get these setters with read, but you don't write them. You don't append them. But you might be able to rename them. Link on link IO control and not relabel them either. Then you have the transition, but you only can create dirs, so you don't, you only have the transition on dir. So this should be the only thing that it actually needs to do. And then we can basically do these. Dir file, link file, sock file. FIFO file, car file, block file. And then just copy this over. This might not be a good idea right now because we might actually nice stuff that it needs, but anyways, read write, and then the get attribute will just remove that for now. So yeah. Do what file managers do. And then on the other hand, they should not do this. But this is still probably a bit early to add this. But only user content. And we need to clean this up. So, considering the attention span issue of people watching, we might just take a break and just see if this builds, and then just take a break before we proceed. Probably a good idea. Yeah, that's probably a good idea. At this point, what we could do is just tail or less var log messages. Yeah, go all the way below and just have a look here. But we need to be a little bit careful here. We know there's some debug chatting going on, but we need to actually be sure that it's all legit But this seems to be legit here. This seems to be legit. So how many lines are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 40. So let's just make that 45. So till and 4, 5 for log messages order to allow. And then most of it, there's just basically a couple. Take care of this, these two, burn and nautilus. So let's take care of burn. It's all the way below. Need to be a little bit careful with this stuff, especially since burn seems to be, oh yeah, burn does connect to the session bus, so that makes sense. So this is one way. This above one, this is to the user session bus, and that's always one way. But this is all bi-directional. Same goes for this here. Bidirectional. Someone says something and someone answers. Someone asks something and someone answers. But that's not with regard to always. That's not regard with the my login user underscore DBC. Yeah, they working hard. They working hard. The money. So yeah, we have Nautilus also doing stuff here. The roofing. That's what they do. And this is search provided, this is not it. The roofing. That's what they do. So this is both bi-directional. Sorry for the coughing. That's my bronchitis. If I with this weather, I have this bronchitis, and you know, when the weather gets in a certain way, so to speak, then my bronchitis starts acting up. That's usually when there's rain coming up. I'm very sensitive to weather, so to speak. But that's also because I live in the environment where I live. So it might just not actually be so much a bronchitis problem as much as it is just a problem of my environment. So let's build this. Been a while since I last built it. Type attribute error. And that's something I usually do, type attribute. I make a typo in there. A usual typo. Forgot the E. Happens a lot. Same here. A common typo. We have this audit access that is not defined for various stuff. So audit access is only defined for character file, log file. Character file, FIFA file, link file, sock file, FIFA file. So I guess it's only for dirs and files, I guess. So now to the out of X. Oh, and there's another nout. There's more nouts. Let's go to the out of X. So this stuff actually. Only applies to dirs and files. I guess. We'll see later, but at least I guess we'll see. We'll just see. Now a bit. SC module has been a long time since I last ran SC module. And then I'll just log out, clear the dirs. Jesus Christ. Yeah, they're working. It happens, is it usually during summertime. Right, so log off. Or at least log on first and then log off. Quick. Log off. Log out. Do my clear stuff. And then I'm gonna take a small break. Oh, and I'll just do this manually. Take a small break and then I'll proceed, because else the sessions get too long and that's not good for your attention spans. Alright, so see you later.